Good morning and good afternoon. This is Monica Paolini from Sensafili, and this is a conversation that is part of a report on AI, machine learning, and all the techniques that we are starting to use in wireless to improve and optimize network performance. And today I have the pleasure to talk to Carolyn Chan. He's the VP and GM and the network business incubator in the data center group at Intel. Carolyn, thanks for sharing your thoughts with us today.
Oh, it's always great to chat with you, Monica.
Same here, and we have done it several times. So this is good to sort of catch up on what is the latest sort of on the AI front. It has become a really hot topic. Why do you think it's so?
Well, I think AI has been around for a long time, and so is machine learning. But really, on the network side, we really start seeing that proliferation of the AI ML, at least very much become a hot topic these days, because we have made dramatic improvement in processing power. Intel has invested, as well as the ecosystem, that we have the Moore's Law really brought down what it takes to process the AI algorithm, the machine learning algorithm, and some of the accelerator that we're putting into our roadmap also really help. So in terms of power efficiency, in terms of the pricing efficiency, overall it makes it more favorable. So you were seeing a lot of the AI and machine learning start popping up in the network topic discussion.
Absolutely, and that's very interesting because, as I say, you know, this is a set of technologies, set of knowledge that we had that has been out forever, but we couldn't really use it. Mm-hmm. So we have all this computational ability to deal with all the data. So the other part is the data that we have access to. That is nothing new, but we're able to combine it together. So how is that? How quick is the change that you're seeing there?
Oh, well, I mean, the change is pretty dramatic. Like, I remember when I started talking about 5G with you and with our customers, really people haven't really talked about AI and ML. People are still really working on the NAV SDN, which you and I have talked about it for quite a few times. We've been really focusing on NAV SDN and also Mac. And I think the combination of all of that, and also everybody start realizing that the 5G network, in a way, although the algorithm itself could be simpler, but the usage model is now dramatically increased from just managing the voice and the going on to internet and browse. Now is you start talking about different verticals, different enterprises. Yesterday, I was spent in an all-day workshop with our industrial automation group in our IoT division, and then with our retail group. You start realizing the network itself has to dramatically improve in terms of how we deal with the demand and also how we work with the output. The data that we extract and data that we need to analyze. Like you said, the data is available to us. It's dramatically changed from just a few years ago. So I think it's almost like a perfect storm, or maybe the perfect interception, where we have this combination of a lot more compute on the network. We have this virtualization that's really start resembling more of a cloud, a data center. You know, people talk about edge data center. It really becomes a more reality than just say on PowerPoint. So as a result of that, we are hearing a lot of network optimization via AI, and also using the data analytics that we have in hand to serve the end user better. Not whether it's a consumer, or a hospitality, a hotel, or an industrial plant.
Yeah, absolutely, and there is this the convergence that really makes it possible, because you have many more dimensions in which you can optimize. If you only have voice, there's not a whole lot of optimization you can do. You either have the capacity or not. So there is more. And one thing also that you briefly mentioned is Mac or edge computing, and I guess slicing as well. How do they fit in this big picture?
Like, yeah, I'll give you an example. We've been working in a different aspect of developing, incubating a different use cases to make the network ROI make sense, right? So when we looked at the using the network serving beyond the B2C, but really look at some of the B2B, I remember we have conversations with part of this group called 5GACIA. It's really focusing on a lot of the industrial automation. I remember sitting in a conference room where we have some industrialists, from Europe, talking about the needs and requirements. You know, for us, it's natural to say, hey, we can tune our network to your needs, Mr. Factory Owners. What come back to us is that realizing this is not just having a network outage so that people can make calls. You really talk about much more stringent requirement. Maybe the production line stop functioning. Maybe even a robot started functioning. You are talking about a lot more dollars and cents, maybe even safety concerns. So the requirements is not just like, oh, you have a network outage. The requirement could be there's a liability discussion. So what we're doing with network slicing end-to-end, people say, well, you're just simply slicing the core network, not slicing the radio network. It's a lot more than that. It's stringing together a slice or maybe even a particular cube paired with the right type of, what I meant is by pair the right type of spectrum, pair the right offload from device to the network in order to serve a particular use cases. We have a couple of pilots going on with some lead industry to and in conjunction partnership with our IoT group to really look at taking some of the control element of a factory and put that on a 5G network, including the edge compute piece. When you add all of that together, you are not talking just about a regular, when I say regular, like the network of the old days. You really had to start applying some of the learnings. The network needs to get smarter, right? It's way beyond just adding another channel cards to meet the capacity requirements. It's really about putting the right processing power, the right latency and SLA, maybe even the right spectrum, the right connectivity onto a particular use case that happened to be in demand of that moment. So you hear a lot about X as a service, function as a service, infrastructure as a service, platform as a service. It in a way that the management of the network is so much more complex. It's beyond what we used to do, having an engineer monitor the capacity of the compute, the usage threat in a network.
Absolutely. And from what you say, it's like you need to optimize the network to extract as much performance as you can. And at the same time is to support the specific use cases. So you optimize, the optimization is both from the operator point of view and from the enterprise applications at the same time. Yeah. It's becoming one and the same thing, which is really crucial because you use AI on sort of in both directions. It's not just one or the other.
In fact, I would just share with you the other day that my first job out of college was working for a major telco equipment manufacturer. And my job was actually monitor one of their customers' network, was actually looking at all the alarms and making decisions whether we should dispatch a new capacity channel cards. Because at the time you need ordering, put in a warehouse and dispatch to the customer side. A lot of that was based on someone was mentoring me and showing me, you know, a lot of it was judgment call, right? There's certain alarms that you hit a 65% usage in the system, then when do you start pulling the plug to add more capacity? And it's really pretty dimensional and also relying on a lot of human intelligence. or rather experience, right? I've seen this, I've seen that before, you better do it now. There is not a very we're not really good at dealing with any kind of multi-dimensional problem, which that's what we are facing now. 4G with Mac, 5G with Mac, and going forward, you are facing a different type of applications. It's not just entertainment. It's not just having a Netflix running. It's about dealing with hospital, telemedicine, dealing with V2X, dealing with factories. The dimension of the inputs coming in, it's coming so much more than what I was when I was sitting in front of a monitor and monitoring this network. I just can't fashion that can be done in the human. You have to add in this machine learning, you have to run in some neural network to read all the inputs, and as well as it should be a closed loop type of activities. So I'm excited to be in this arena facing this dilemma, facing all these issues. And I believe that we will be able to solve it with AI, with machine learning, with Mac, and the processing power that we are having in our hands today.
Yeah, and as you say, it's all very exciting. It's a great opportunity, but it's also a need. It's not just an optional thing that you do on the side, because that's really crucial to make sure that all the applications, for instance, healthcare applications, are safe.
Yeah,
it's not just a question of KPIs that you show to your investors at the end of the month.
It's absolutely right. And now I want to share another example. We actually faced this at the very beginning when we start talking about Mac. I remember we were proposed by one of the major hotel chain and also owns a large casino. They have typically with casino you have these frequent shopper program, or rather their favorite club program, where you do know a lot about your people that stay with you. I'm a frequent stayer in the Marriott property. So they know a lot about me. They know about my preference. What they want to do is apply that and personalize the experience of their guests. And they want to achieve that because they get a much better user experience as you stay. In this particular case, they actually have different concerts. One is a country music, one is a hip hop. So you know the people that go to those concerts have very different, maybe spending habits, maybe preferences. As they come out of the concert, you want to treat them differently when they go into your hotel. You want to give them a much more personalized experience. And they want to do that with Edge Compute. At the time, we couldn't. It was a very early stage of Edge Compute. We did not pursue that pilot. But today, we very much would like to do that, because you have all this information in your fingertips, right? As long as you could take that information, add upon it, using the fact that you know the guests is in your hotel, because they are on your network, right? You can match their SIM card to your guest preference. How do you then deliver a much better personalized experience to them? And that is actually a very hot topic. So I've been already talking with different hospitality owners about that. How do we take that learning? How do we know, because we are on the network, the operator do know who you are, how do we apply that specifically to enrich how a venue can treat their guests?
And there's a lot of opportunities, but as you mentioned, you're talking to a hotel or a casino, so you need to have an ecosystem that goes beyond the operators and the vendors. How what kind of ecosystem do we need? Is it in place, or what do we need to get it in place?
I think everybody recognizes that not just you and I. A lot of the operators also now start recognizing the partnership that they need to have is stand way beyond what they traditionally work with, the device people and the infrastructure guys. we start building within Intel, we call something called Network Builder, and now we extend that to something called Edge Builder. So the partnership that we're talking about, what I just mentioned, is a lot of the developers, people that write code, that write specific application for the vertical. I think that as our job, as a part, when I say us, as a part of the infrastructure, is we need to provide a horizontal platform that has virtualized capability, much like what we do today in the cloud side. The cloud provider do provide a very efficient way of onboard, securely onboard devices, securely onboard different applications, and allowing a flexible use of their compute functions and service comes to mind. We need to create that same type of capabilities through ecosystem building for the network, such that we can fully leverage all the things that 5G promises. Otherwise, I think it'd be a total miss of all the 5G that can return to the ecosystem.
No, absolutely. It's going to be necessary for that. Now, you mentioned security. That's going to be also, and it's another pretty big topic as you get a bigger ecosystem, more players involved. And is there a role there for to learn there as well? Because security, it's also an ongoing challenge. You need to learn how to things.
Yeah, very much so. I can't even imagine any conversation that we've had today don't have that. Security is always a top of mind. That we had to go through different security checkpoint and information. Especially if you're going to talk to about an enterprise, they have some proprietary information they want to hold on site. They don't necessarily want to have that being in the cloud or in the network. Many people still want to have a private cloud. Having security like blockchain technology that we're looking at, apply that to the network. We're looking at secure onboard of a device, secure onboard of application, isolation of application, such that if one application goes wrong, it does not impact the rest of the network or the other enterprises. So all of that all comes to the play. I would say a lot of the vertical use cases that we are talking about, security is probably number one requirements. If you don't solve that, you really come marching to the next step. AI or machine learning are the benefits, but security is it is the fundamental that we have to provide.
Now, a few years ago, if you talk to operators or the enterprise, would be like, hey, AI, do we trust it? We don't know, how has that changed? And do you think that is the enterprise or the operators the ones more aggressive moving forward?
I say both, actually. The operators are really, the ones that we've been engaging with, really talking about using AI machine learning to improve the network efficiency and serve their customer better. The enterprises are very much keen to using AI and machine learning to gather more data and run a much more in time, data analytics, and that they can reuse and serving both in the short term and the longer term to save that data and allow them to improve their operational efficiency. Both. I don't see a big differences. I think both are marching. Especially with 5G, I think the operators very much recognize the fact that they need to apply some AI into running, managing the network more efficiently.
Now let's look at the other side. In terms of challenges, what is that might sort of slow them down a bit?
A lot of the regulations like data, the ability to acquire data, to learn from data, that's the reason why when we looked at the regional differences, I see China probably are a bit more advanced because the customs, there's less of awareness of data privacy. So the enterprises there, the operator do have access to a mass amount of data. The cameras everywhere, the smart cameras everywhere. We actually see, because we're involved in some of these, we actually see that they it's about learning, right? If AI means you have more data, so you can learn on top of it, you can improve. It's a closed loop process. So when we looked at the major cloud providers there, like Alibaba, Baidu, and Tencent, they're very focusing on acquiring data, using the data to improve their operations, improve how they serve the customers, and all three operators. So as a society as a whole, I've seen a lot more improvement in the advancement in China because some of the regulatory concern, but not to say that the Western world are not working on it. I definitely, there's a lot of startups that are around, and I hope that you will get to talk to some of them. They do some amazing work to advance AI machine learning on the network.
Absolutely, and but as I say, you know, there are differences in different parts of the world. So, you mentioned in China, is there any work you're specifically doing there that you can tell us more about?
Yeah, a couple months ago, we announced that we are working on a smart roadside unit project in China in collaboration with Alibaba. It's a smart transportation. They've announced an initiative. It's not just Intel, there's a lot of companies are involved, the car companies and so on. We are one of the partners. So the idea is to take a roadside unit today does not have a lot of compute, to advance that, to provide a different architecture where you don't just take the data, but actually analyze all the radar, LiDAR data information, camera information that you get, and to improve both the car safety. Clearly, autonomous driving is supposed to be self-sufficient. It does not really require the network. Otherwise, we'll be scared to get on the autonomous driving car. But also to help with some of the smart city initiative, like knowing where the road signs need to be repaired, maybe knowing where the car, the roads need some repair, traffic congestion, managing the traffic pattern flow. So it's a government has initiative to improve the road congestion in China is horrible, a lot of pollution issues. So they're using this kind of information to help improve the road safety as well as make the city much more intelligent. So we're involving that. It's very early. I would say it's clearly in the early proof of concept phase, but we wanted to take the compute power and use that to make the V2X a much more rewarding, more than just saying, hey, I'm here, here's a pole to hang the equipment, but also to take the data and analyze the data and ingest the data to come back to the to serve a better and how you manage the road traffic.
Now, let me ask you, you know, we've been talking about AI in the network, but what about the devices? Is there any role for the devices in driving the learning about the network and improving optimizing performance?
Yeah, I believe so. I have to say I'm not an expert on the device side, but talking with our device team, they're very much looking at using some of the AI learning to understand when does the devices needed to offload some of the some of the workloads onto the network. It's something that people are talking about, and I hope that the same progress that we made in edge mech will play a role into a smart offload from a device onto the network, especially when you look at some of that gaming. Some of the very sophisticated AR, VR, how do we offload such that the device continue to be very reasonably priced and power consumption, but leveraging the fact that you're gonna have all these cloudlets or the edge cloud near you. I think those will be a very interesting topic that I hope the ecosystem will focus on.
Very final question, 5G. That's necessary one. So how is 5G and AI? I mean, you commented a little bit before in terms of how mm-hmm. do they sort of need each other. But do you see people just waiting for 5G before they do AI or vice versa, or any dependency there?
I don't think that we're waiting for 5G to do AI. 5G does demand AI, push AI, enhances AI performance. But we've seen then people doing that today, if on in a combination of LTE and Mac. We are involved in some of the projects already. So I don't think people are waiting, but I think 5G and AI definitely go hand in hand, will benefit each other. But no, I don't advocate that at all. In fact, we started doing AI work on the LTE and Mac network already today.
Caroline, thank you so much for sharing your thoughts with us today.
Thank you.
And thank you all for listening in. And this interview is also available in the transcript form. So if you want, you can read it as well. Thank you so much.